The following program is shot in 4K high dynamic range and broadcast in high definition from Capital Broadcasting Company.
Nurseries, plants need to be spaced further apart as they grow. Robots do that at this one near Charlotte.
They've been a big labor savings for us.
At this textile company near Hickory, robots, not people, sew socks.
We can do with half the labor that we would normally have to do on the manual.
This manufacturer in Sanford makes robots to help other manufacturers make things too.
And it doesn't make mistakes.
Community college students are learning how to make machines that relieve human hands of menial tasks.
The jobs that require very little skill are the jobs that are being eliminated.
And university students are learning how to program robots to do the same.
We're destined to become a more automated society.
What's the downside?
There will be substantial job loss in that process.
And what's the upside?
Somebody's got to make the robots.
Jobs will be gained, and jobs will be lost as robots change the future of work.
This is the best machine on the market that money can buy.
Mark Bess's machines do almost all of the work at the textile company that he runs in Conover.
This machine here is knitting a sock right now, compression sock, a knee high.
And it's a far cry from his early days in the textile industry.
Been in it for 35 years. Everything in the 80s and 90s was manual. You have to do everything.
He worked for multiple companies, only to be laid off multiple times.
They just moved overseas. They moved to Mexico, Honduras, China.
His last stop was in Burlington, working for a huge hosiery company called Gold Toe. Bess was one of about 1,200 employees.
One of the best jobs I ever had, and they closed down. They moved to Mexico. We shipped every machine down there, 1,200 machines. Put it all down there. We trained all the people, got them all going. As soon as we got them going there, they laid us all off.
Bess came back to his home in Catawba County and found an opportunity with a startup called U Apparel, making medical compression socks.
It's been one of the best moves I've ever made in my life.
The company got help from a business incubator called the Manufacturing Solutions Center.
Our basic mission is to create jobs here in the U.S.
The MSC gave U Apparel building space and helped it implement automation.
People talk about, well, it's advanced manufacturing. Well, if you're in business today, you better be advanced manufacturing. I don't know of hardly any industry that is not advanced.
They played a big role. We would not be in business if it wasn't for them.
Bess is one of only two full-time employees here because these robots sew the socks.
You have the touch screens here. Everything here is like an iPad.
Bess programs the robot, and it makes the sock without ever being touched by a human hand.
It would take double the people with the older machine to do what this one machine here does. This machine here will make about three socks to one sock of the old machine. And so it takes out a whole department so we can cut labor out to make it competitive with China and Mexico.
Bess is fighting Mexico and China's cheap labor with less labor.
We can do more with less, but we have to have skilled labor. It's North Carolina versus the world. And that's the way you have to look at it now. We have to be global and be able to compete globally to make it work.
About 35 miles southeast of Conover in the Mecklenburg County town of Huntersville is the sprawling Metrolina Greenhouses. It grows and sells flowering plants to big box stores like Lowe's and Walmart.
Geraniums, begonias, impatiens, hostas, daylilies, echinacea, so all the things that you would plant in your yard or decorate your house with.
Metrolina spans 15 million square feet, half outside, half inside.
So we're the single largest single-story heated building in America. Typical mall is 1.2 to 1.3 million square feet, so we could get 5.5 malls inside of here.
Art Van Wingerden says that automation has helped this company grow since his dad opened it here in 1972.
We probably started with automation in the late 70s. One of my dad's favorite sayings was automate or stagnate, so you're going to do one or the other.
Plants on raised tables are moved on conveyor systems.
So all the tables here, they roll, and you know, they go back and forth. So most greenhouses you go to, everything's on the ground.
A crane system moves tables too. An overhead conveyor system takes hanging plants to a single watering source rather than taking water to each plant.
So on how we just water in one spot here, just like a ski lift.
These robots stick plant cuttings in small pots of dirt. They use cameras to find the stem.
The stem needs to go in, so it has to be able to see that. An average person can stick 800 to 900 cuttings per hour. This machine can do about 2,400 cuttings per hour. That is what it looks like when it's stuck.
These robots space plants further apart as they grow.
They can see the plant, they have cameras on it, and it has pinchers that actually grab the pot. Then it goes back to the strip, that's how it knows where it's going, and then it's gonna set it down. The thing on top is this GPS, so it knows exactly where it's been and all that. An average robot can space about 230, 240 pots per hour. To space this many pots by hand, it would take 9 people to do this. Right now we have 3 people to do it. They've been a big labor savings for us. People generally don't like spacing.
We're not a typical greenhouse. So there are a lot of greenhouses in America that still do it what we consider the old-fashioned way.
On average, Metrolina Greenhouses has about 2,000 employees. And Ben Wingerden says that he'd need double that without automation.
We wouldn't be as big as we are today without automation. Obviously, we don't need as much labor. Labor, you know, costs money. A lot of times people look at automation and say automation takes employees away, but it really doesn't take employees away. It benefits the ones that are here even more.
Van Wingerden says that's because lower labor costs allow him to pay his employees more for this kind of work and offer more benefits like health insurance.
Employees should never be fearful at Metrolina Greenhouses that automation is going to replace them. All the automation we have to have people that run that machine, but we have to have people that are more highly skilled to be able to run those machines.
Check the height of the whole block.
Next, is our education system doing enough to give people the skills they need to find and keep good jobs?
We're actually being trained to help young people create their own jobs of the future.
This relatively small building in Sanford is home to a lot of big ideas. In fact, Mertech Solutions was North Carolina's Small Business of the Year in 2017.
So if you got any kind of car made anywhere, you can just about bet somewhere one of our machines put something together for it.
President Jerry Pedley shows me some of the products that are made by Mertech machines in a display case in the front lobby and in his office, like this common computer connector that's made up of multiple tiny parts.
So our machine would put this whole assembly together, and we could probably put this assembly area, put one of these together over 4 or 5 seconds.
Mertech made the machine for the customer that uses it to make the connectors.
They say make me a machine so I can make that.
Yes, that's correct.
About 60% of Mertech's machines go to the automotive industry, about 25% to the medical industry, and the rest to companies that make consumer goods.
And we've already done one of these that's a little bit smaller.
They're manufacturers that want to automate assembly lines with robotics.
If you program this robot to do this task day in and day out, he will always do that task. He's not going to change.
So this is all done with robotics and cameras, and we pick the part up and we put the part together every 10 seconds.
To build his machines, Pedley needs workers with both hands-on and technical skills. He says that about 75% of his employees come from community colleges, and about half from nearby Central Carolina Community College in Sanford.
And then when you tap it, make sure you put it in low gear, as low a speed as you're going to be able to run.
They get trained in the college's computer integrated machining department.
They build tools to make products that are used every day in any industry, automotive, electronics, electrical.
Have you roughed out your hex nut? Okay, so you've got
that's
that.
That's why I'm waiting on the boring part.
Oh, okay, I got you.
We start with manual machines, and we go all the way through computer numerical controlled equipment. Our job is to basically keep up with technology and make sure the students leave here with an advanced knowledge of technology and how it relates to manufacturing the products.
David Thompson got a degree from NC State in aerospace engineering. He worked in it for a while, but he returned to school, this time to Central Carolina Community College, to get a degree in tool and die manufacturing.
I've always enjoyed working with my hands. Unfortunately, one of the downfalls in higher education today is that they like to focus on book learning and theory, and there's very little practical application thereof. Having spent all this time going and making these parts, it's turning around and making me a better engineer.
I think that automation creates more jobs.
This is all an automatic process.
Automation created a job for Rishikant Mishra at the Ogden Group in Matthews.
Together with our partners, we supply automated solutions to the woodworking industry. And typically right now that's being done in the industry manually, and we develop machine lines that fully automate that whole process.
Mishra is finishing up his work on this radio frequency press that he helped design, build, and program. It will go to a customer that's automating its laminated flooring business.
All these woodworking companies used to have a lot of people, a lot of operators running their machines. With the advent of automation, you cut the human operators out, and what you have are faster machines that are much more repeatable, which give you better precision, and they're highly reliable.
Mishra graduated with an engineering degree from NC State and says he got a lot of practical experience in the Department of Industrial and Systems Engineering Automation Lab.
The most important fact here is the user-friendly interface of Baxter.
One of the things students do here is learn how to program a robot named Baxter just to do simple tasks. Baxter is a collaborative robot, meaning it's meant to work side by side with humans.
She knows the exact spots where it has to drop.
Where you would see a robot such as this is on a, perhaps on an assembly line, or doing something that is dull, dirty, and very tedious, perhaps, or dangerous.
Yeah. Program where I want him to go and let go, and then you punch in that task.
Students also program the lab's newest robot, Sawyer. Sawyer is similar to Baxter, but it's more precise and accurate and can work in smaller spaces.
Our industrial engineering students are really good at optimizing processes and finding inefficiencies in processes. Most of our students will have multiple job offers at the time of graduation.
Lowe says that's an example of how automation is creating more jobs than it's replacing.
If we don't embrace automation into our processes as manufacturers in America, we'll be losing jobs to other places.
Take us through your three tasks.
A university robotics lab and a community college machine shop might seem worlds apart, but both skill sets are needed in the world of automated manufacturing.
We don't want the tap to actually bottom out.
Labor's cheap, but skill is expensive. And so we train more to skill, not just labor.
As our state and country's economic base moves more from low-tech labor to high-tech skill, some say our education and training systems are lagging behind, meaning
there will be substantial job loss in that process. We have to train
people to create their own futures.
Johnson says the skills that students need are the same whether they go to a community college or a four-year university.
The key to thriving and prospering is going to be based on how to mine loads of information and look for creative and innovative ideas in that information. Because the new normal in our economy and society is certain uncertainty. It creates a challenge for higher education because we're basically being asked to train young people for jobs that haven't been created yet.
Johnson says it creates a challenge for the K-12 education system too.
How do we reinvent public education in such a way that people are able to think no small thoughts? And so what we want to do is unleash the entrepreneurial spirit and acumen, and I think the job creation piece will take care of itself.
Next, a look at the potential job losses as training and education lag behind rapidly advancing automation.
We need to be training people for jobs that don't exist yet, where they'll be using technologies that haven't been invented yet in order to solve problems that we don't know are problems yet.
Tanika Hyman works for a communications company that bundles bills and provides support for telephone and internet service and other technology.
Anything related to technology and communications, we basically do it.
She's seen automation changing her workplace.
A lot of the things that we used to input manually, we don't have to do that anymore.
Hyman's a little worried that automation might one day replace her.
You can take two or three positions and you can combine it because you have the system that's doing it for you now.
So Hyman enrolled at Wilson Community College to get an accounting degree, saying that it will make her a more valuable employee.
And it's just gonna just open up everything for me and as far as what I want to do in my future.
Some protection against the potential impact of automation is probably a good idea. NC State's Institute for Emerging Issues has created what it calls a Future Work Disruption Index, trying to predict the impact of automation on jobs.
In tourism-oriented communities like Carteret or Watauga or Buncombe, you find that we're predicting that roughly 40% of jobs are going to go away over the next 20 years.
That's because service-oriented workers like cashiers, waiters, and housekeepers are vulnerable.
We believe that there are 39 professions where there's a 70% chance that jobs are going to disappear over the next 20 years.
Boney says they're everything from bank tellers to truck drivers, people who perform tasks that can be automated. Some of the safest jobs are one where people want or need more personal or physical interaction.
If you look at the very bottom, the jobs least likely are physical therapists and ministers.
Differentiation. Cratering.
Boney says the right education is the best defense against job elimination.
Educational programs need to spring up in order to respond to this, and I think we've been slow in education to get those programs ready.
In the last class, what did we talk about?
Getting people to think for themselves is important as well.
When you have a lifelong learning mindset and you are a master of information management, you're less likely to be blindsided by unanticipated change.
There's automation throughout our own lives, of course, from robot customer service representatives.
Currently, our staff is assisting other callers. Your call will be answered in the order it was received.
To the robots who guided us to our shoot locations for this documentary.
Continue on Western Boulevard for a half mile.
And there are robots here at WRAL as well. As a matter of fact, the cameras capturing me broadcasting the news are robots. This makes me wonder, can I be replaced by a robot too?
I think there's a trust factor that ultimately, unless Westworld gets a lot better or becomes closer to reality, people are still going to want to see a real person. But I think ultimately it comes down to wanting to see someone that you trust tell you something that you want to believe.
That makes me feel a little bit better.
This KUKA robot will make sure it's okay.
But rather than worry about technology taking our jobs, maybe we should embrace all of its positives, as Mertech President Jerry Pedley does.
technology is changing faster than I ever imagined.
Is that a good thing?
It's absolutely a good thing.
Because?
It helps us produce things at a more economical cost. We're getting a global world now where everybody can compete and everybody's working together. Technology is good for us.